I can, I will, I am. I can, I will, I am. I can, I will, I am. Full stop on the wow. Welcome to the video. Always get back to the wow and feel it. It completely flips the script internally. Now, today we are, what's going on? Well, obviously, I went to the Weather Channel to get the forecast for today. I wanted to see, you know, what's it going to be like. And then this big, huge emergency. Biggest storm in history about ready to hit Mexico. I said, what? Well, it sort of popped out of nowhere. And this is very, very relevant to what we've been saying here. And I think a couple of videos ago, maybe the last one, I talked about this meeting with somebody who said that it's going, something is going to come up real fast and expect stuff to come up unexpectedly real, real fast. Well, here's a perfect example of that. So this storm was a tropical depression, then a tropical storm, but it's nothing that would cause anybody to be concerned. We know there are people from our town that are down there in timeshare, you know, just Puerto Vallarta, and you know, you wake up in the morning and it's nice and no big deal, and people thought, oh well, there's a little tropical storm down there far away, you know, it's a big deal. And then they say, oh, guess what, it increased by, wind speeds increased by 100 miles an hour overnight or more, you know, and it's coming. And what? So this is very, very interesting, because it plays into the theme that we've been saying. I've been saying this for so long. It gets more intense faster than we realize here. And that's why what may seem to be preemptive actions may not be quite like that. It may be just reasonable actions. We're misunderstanding. We're not aware of the speed of change that's happening right now. Now, I was reading this book, quite interesting, this morning. I just picked this book up by Yogananda. I just was on the bookshelf. I saw a book and looked at it, and I opened it up, and it said, you know, that all events in the world are caused by our thoughts, including the weather, and that these tornadoes, these hurricanes, these earthquakes, these droughts, these floods, everything is a reflection of our thinking, actually. Now, this is also similar to what Eckhart Tolle has said and what the non-dual teachers have said. This world is just a reflection of our thinking. It's a reflection of our belief system. So that means, if you look at it from that standpoint, you can get a better idea of what is to come in the world. Because if you see what our intentions are, what our thinking patterns are, et cetera, you know, you can say, well, this is what's going to happen in the world. So this very rapid, now, of course, they blame it on El Nino, but what does El Nino blame on? Well, they blame that on anthropogenic warming, but what is that based on? I mean, you got to give, for me, I give faith to the great sages, and when they say, hey, it's all based on our thoughts, this whole planet, actually, all of nature, everything that we're experiencing here, is our own thoughts, our own thinking. Now, of course, they contradict themselves when they do the perennial explanation of the Indian subcontinent about that. They always ask, but why are we suffering? This is all a dream of God. It's a cosmic dream of God. God's playing a game with God, with himself, and just for the sake of variety and fun. And but why is there so much suffering and sickness and death? And they say, well, you know, God wouldn't have as much fun if it was easy or something. It makes it the God's playing a game of hide and seek with himself, and it makes it funner to find himself and all that. You know, they go through these things that there's a huge difference between that explanation and the explanation Jesus has given. So I always felt that their explanation for coming from the Indian subcontinent about, you know, explaining this type of question was not really giving the full context. It was sort of avoiding it. Jesus doesn't avoid it at all. He goes right into this and tells us plain and simple what this suffering and misery is all about. And we're trying to deceive God. He says it's an attack on God, an attempt to deceive God. And it's not really God's play, you know. That's a big difference. And also, the Trinity is very important in Jesus' teaching. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit is crucial, and they don't, you know, really go into that either. So, I find like A Course in Miracles to be a more direct, bigger context sort of thing. Now, there may be a reason for that, because we're in such a crisis right now. It may have been time to, you know, bring this challenge upon us, whereas previously maybe that was just too much of a challenge for people to see that, and they didn't even bother. They just said, well, God's playing a little game of hide and seek, you know, that kind of like a tooth fairy thing. So I don't know, it probably could be something like that, because I've said, like Shankar said, well, I give different answers depending on who I'm speaking with, and that's a tradition in the subcontinent. It tends to be somewhat of a tradition there too, so you cannot rely necessarily on what they say. You know, it's kind of like telling the kid, you know, oh yeah, who brought the gifts? Oh, Santa Claus brought the gifts. Oh, really? Okay, great. And you know, they don't worry about it anymore. And they say, no, just don't worry, just meditate, don't worry about that question. Why? But here we know the cat's out of the bag. Actually, cat's out of the bag. Now today, in spite of this tremendous storm, which everybody's kind of like, wow, how did that happen so fast? I think it hit landfall already, 165 miles per hour. Well, that's incredible. I'm used to like 135 being really high. 165, it sustained 165. That's insane. So, you know, the intensity of this planet is happening faster than we know. Holy Spirit always emphasizes this urgency, urgency, urgency. It's going to hit us sooner than we realize, the troubles. Now, I'd hate to be in Jalisco right now, that area. Colima and Puerto Vallarta, etc. You know, and just the amount of rain, you know, up to 20 inches, etc. This is a deluge. This is really another catastrophe, so to speak, in the world. That's a reflection of our beliefs. So today, again, a constant stream of insight today. I'm just saying, wow, 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 wow. I can't keep up with it. So you just have to say, oh, that's fine. I just can't keep up with it. But I just go into the wow, and that's great. No problem. We just have to respond here a little bit here. Constant stream of insight, just looking at the wow and just accepting the wow. Okay. There you go. At least I'm not driving. I don't text and drive. I don't know why people send me texts while I'm driving. I'm driving so much. Oh, this is ridiculous. I know I'm not going to read them. Just call. Just call. It's easy. Talk to somebody. So we have a baseball game, Game 6, Royals and Blue Jays. Have this big storm hitting. I'm not watching it, okay? I'm not watching it. I'm here taping. This is what I say. Walk the walk. Walk the walk. Talk the talk. Walk the walk. I say try to ignore pretty much what's going on in the world, and continue to focus on the wow of positivity, that I'm succeeding. I can succeed. I will succeed. I have succeeded. I have already succeeded. I can succeed. I will succeed. I have already succeeded. I can experience the imperishable. I will experience the imperishable. I am experiencing the imperishable. Okay. I can experience the imperishable. I will experience the imperishable. I am experiencing the imperishable. This is very, very crucial now. So we're getting into this topic of what the imperishable. Which is right where we need to be right now. And this has the power to bring up the wow reaction. Now, Now, even if there was just the tiniest, tiniest, tiniest ray of hope that we could find and experience the imperishable, for me, it'd be worth it to then put all my efforts in that direction, because I absolutely hate this feeling of perishableness, which is what we call the world. What is it really? We're experiencing perishability. We're experiencing perishability. Okay, this is a word we haven't used before, perishability. I hate perishability. I loathe it. So even the tiniest, tiniest, tiniest little bit of hope that there's a way to escape it, I'm all in, all in. And why not? Now, if you use the term impermanence, it's a little bit troublesome, because what the ego says is that, well, it'll just make impermanent, this mirage. It's actually a mirage, actually, we're seeing. Okay, the impermanence is a mirage. The perishability is a mirage, a belief-based mirage. And just go on faith on this, as I have, and I'm recognizing now why this is so. If we say it's impermanent, then the ego will say, well, I'll just make this mirage permanent, and that should fix it. And we say, sometimes not quite right with that reasoning. But if we say, you know, perishable, we want the imperishable. It's a little more difficult. The ego can say, well, I'll make this dream, this perishableness, imperishable. I can say that too. And say, okay, we fixed it. This is the ego's logic. It says, I fixed it. I made the impermanent permanent. Well, it's a mirage of impermanence. The ego says, I'll make this mirage of impermanence that's actually not true. I'll make that permanent. But impermanence is not true. So how can we make impermanence permanent? It doesn't add up the way the ego looks at it. The way the ego says, either I'll just try to make do and be happy and find ways to be happy in impermanence or the perishability, or I'll make perishability imperishable, so it always remains. That's the ego. But the third option is to set down the perishable for the imperishable. Now, continuity fear is involved in this. We're just kind of looking at this. And it's you have to let the fear dissipate around this area of perishability. Okay, so it's not able, you can't really force it, these insights, but I've been having these insights and clearing it all up. So the very least we can do is say, wow, we can look at this directly. But if we rush it, we'll start struggling and trying to remember, and it becomes a problem. Beautiful evening here, by the way. Just the dusk is falling here beautifully. So we're looking at this perishability and imperishability. Our experience here is with perishability. Everything has this perishability. This is what we're experiencing. Now, how do you get around it? How do you get free of this notion? I say it's a mirage. It's a mirage. It's not true. So how can we make something that's not true permanent? It was never true in the first place. Making it permanent, what does that mean? Maybe the only thing we could say is permanently deluded. Our own permanent delusion is what it would mean. But why do we want to be permanently deluded? That's no fun. There's nothing in the first place that is arising as a thing. So there's no life actually arising at all in this appearing. There's no world really arising at all. It's only just an appearance, all appearance in the now. Everything inherently released in the now. So that's the permanency of it all. So it's permanently what it is. So this belief that we're viewing impermanence as if it was some sort of natural dynamic of process is not true at all. Not true, it's a mirage. Same with, you know, perishability, perishing. It's just change. There's just a changing of appearances. It's all a play of appearances, actually. But every appearance is completely released in the now. Completely released in the now. Completely released in the imperishable now. So there's only this imperishability really present. That's what's actually present. This is what the great sages tell us, and we have faith in them. So we're taking a look. They say, look at this. It's called inquiry. It's just taking a very, very careful look. Ram Maharshi called inquiry. Krishnamurti might say, let's look at this together. Let's take a look at this. You know, let's. And that's all we do. It's just, we just take a look and say, what can we see here? Certainly, we're not happy with this feeling of perishability, are we? I can't stand it. And it's a funny thing, though. We'd rather have perishability than imperishability. Imperishability frightens us because of the continuity fear, right? So we say, oh, no, I need perishability. Just make it seem nicer, you know. This is what the people want from one another. Just make it nicer. Or make it permanent. So then that'll, they think that'll take away the problem. Oh, no, this imperishability is a permanent feeling of imperishability. So that won't perish. So the feeling of imperishability won't perish. And the ego says, well, that's good. That's what you want, right? You want that's imperishable. No, we want to recognize that there's no such thing as perishability, actually. That's what we want to realize. So the ego's out of whack, to say the least. Now, we get kind of frightened when we realize we've never been born, we've never died, nothing has ever been born, nothing has ever died, because that strikes close to home. We say, hey, well, that sounds like home. And now, here's the trouble, is that the continuity fear is so severe that we want to maintain this mirage of perishability forever. This is why we say, let's make it permanent. That's the continuity fear speaking. He says, I don't want to drop this ever. Now, why would the continuity fear feel this way? Why do we feel this way? Let's inquire into this. Because, this is why, that in our great fear, thinking that this mirage, this pretending to be perishable is what we really are, and this is our functioning and our identity and all this, we want to keep it. We're terrified to let it go. So we do everything we can think of to keep it. And one of the major ways we do to keep this is pretend. Imagine that God is the one who is in charge of this mirage of perishability, who made this, who created this, who's in charge of. So then we say, oh, okay, God, okay, that's great. So that means God will never, you know, will always be this way. Then we think, well, wait a minute, what if God changes, you know, has a mind change about it, changes. So we say, oh, no, we need to worship God and let God know what we want. So we pray and worship this God. We just make it up and say, oh yeah, God's in charge of imperishability. God created perishability. God's in charge of perishability. God's really in charge of imperishability. See, so the God of perishability, it doesn't exist. There is no such God, but we displace through the true God of imperishability, displace that onto perishability and insist that this is just a game of God's play. And we say, God, please, we love your play. Keep playing your play. Don't stop your play. And we're terrified because there is no such God. This is just a displacement of the true God. We're very insecure about this. And so we keep doing rituals to this imaginary God, prayers. We go to church. We pay attention. We pray, oh God, we're such sinners, you know. Because what we're saying is, when we say we're such sinners, we're really saying, hey, we have this. We really don't like this perishability. God actually, and you might know that. I hope you don't know it, but you might. So we're kind of trying to cover that. We say, yeah, God, we know we're really sinners, really terrible sinners, awful, you know, but please overlook that. And that's not what we really want. What we really want is to keep this perishability, mirage of perishability going. See, there's a very upside down, backwards relationship with God in addressing, you know, a God where God is not, you know, displaced image of God, and then having a bizarre relationship with this image, trying to forge, you know, trying to say, don't pay attention to what I'm saying, God, that I really hate this, and I want, you know, imperishable. Don't pay attention to any of that. That's crazy. That's my evil side. That's my sinful side. That's the delusional side. Don't listen to that. Only listen to what I tell you. I want to keep this. I want to keep this. You know, don't change your mind, God. Don't listen to me. And so we dream of this all God that, you know, like this. And this is what, so when we think, hey, I really want to finally set down perishability and experience the imperishable, which is pure spaciousness, of course. Some say consciousness or pure awareness, pure consciousness, pure awareness, pure spaciousness, you know, the isness, the nowness. When we're really to set down perishability. Well, we think, wait a minute, God created perishability. This is God's play. And if we get free of that, there won't be any God. And if there won't be any God, we say, well, there won't be any me. And so I'll be annihilated. And so this really feeds our fear, is we say, wait. So when we displace God in our minds to some place with God, with some role that God doesn't have, which is the role of fostering perishability, to drop perishability, then we think it means to drop God. So we think, well, I do that, there'll be no God, no reality, nothing, I'll be annihilated. Very, very, very strong block that we have there. And so we just need to look at that and say, wow. So this is the kind of insights I have during the day. You know, very deep, fundamentally deep insights are just flowing, 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 flowing like this. So of course people are, they're frantic, say, God, don't stop this. You know, you love your creation of impermanence and perishability. My gosh, who are we not to like that? You know, we're just these humans who are born to die. Come on, God, you could, you know, don't listen to that inner voice that tells you we don't like it. No, that's wrong. That's the devil. Don't listen. That's terrible. So secretly we have this great stress and fear. However we hold this, keep this dream going of the perishable, we're always being insecure because part of us, you know, hates it, doesn't want it at all. And we have to somehow account for that part, somehow. And so that we'll never be at peace as long as we have this dream. Never, 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 because we hate it. We want to set it down and go back to the imperishable reality, you know, imperishable freedom. So how are we ever going to have a civilization society based on, you know, the idea of let's make this mirage permanent? You know, we don't really want to make it permanent in the first place. That's just sort of desperate clutching at straws. So we'll always have this feeling that we're somehow being undermining ourselves, and like sin, we think I have some original sin. In other words, I believe my origin doesn't have anything to do with perishability. And they think, oh, that's a terrible, terrible thought. God's offended. We deny the authorship of God. And so this is the kind of, you know, the egoic thoughts and fears and worries that we have. It's like, wow. Only problem with California weather is it doesn't make all the cars disappear. If it did, then we'd really have something. But zoom, 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 zoom. It's like going, like I've been in a battle zone. I feel like I've been to war every day, actually. Just crazy. The danger is there. Wow, just so crazy. So we can see that this whole thing of God being the creator of impermanence and this so-called play that we call existence, this blocks us from really true insight and true recognition. Which is really the experiencing of permanence and the imperishable, the permanently imperishableness of pure spaciousness, pure awareness, pure consciousness, pure being, pure isness, pure nowness, pure non-dualness, pure abidance, pure immersion, pure allness, pure God, pure spirit, pure Holy Spirit. It gets in our way. It prevents it. Too much fear. We think we'll lose God. We say, God, if I set down your creation, of course I'll be separated from you. Well, we think that this realm of impermanence and imperishability is God's kingdom. Well, of course we would be terrified to set it down, but it's not God's kingdom. So when you get an insight, just trust the fact that you did see it, and don't go back and second guess. This causes a problem. Just say, okay, I saw it. I know I can experience the imperishable. I know I will experience the imperishable. I know I am experiencing the imperishable right now. I am experiencing the imperishable right now. People say, well, you're separate from God, then you're separated from God. What are you doing? Egomaniac, you want to be separate from God? No. We are worshiping a displaced image of God. That's what ego worship is. Worshiping a displaced image. And we're saying, no to that here. We're saying, oh, no. There isn't any God holding impermanence, creating impermanence, creating. Because ultimately, there isn't any thingness or process arising at all, really. It's all just, ultimately, it's all just pure spaciousness. And just a dream of appearancing. Now, many insights, you have to just trust that you're just depositing to your bank account. Your bank account is growing. Instead of saying, wait a minute, what are the insights I had today? I can't remember. Oh, that means I did not have had them. This is really bad to do it that way. Don't think you have to sit down and remember everything that you, all insights you had in the day. It's better to stay in the now. When you have an insight, you just say, wow, this is great, great progress here. Really tremendous. And just experience it that way, and don't think, oh, I'm going to have to remember this at some point. No, it's already been deposited. So we just look at our bank account and say, wow, look at how much more insight and recognition has been deposited in our bank account. Now, these big storms are going to give, you know, impetus to a climate change legislation, no question about it. what gives impetus to us truly repenting and going from worshiping time to honoring time? Well, troubles, misery, suffering, the suffering of this mirage of perishability. Now, it's true that if we are Holy Spirit deniers, you know, get that term from climate deniers. They talk about climate deniers, climate change deniers being so terrible. Well, Holy Spirit deniers is way incalculably worse, you know, as far as denial goes. That's the denial you can't, nobody can afford to make that denial. Because if they do, they will continue, no matter what appears, they will continue to believe that it's perishability, that they're being confronted with perishability, okay? As long as they're Holy Spirit denier, this is what will happen. And by Holy Spirit, you know, we mean also, you know, it's this, don't have to use that word. It could be, you know, the grace of God, the grace of God, the inner voice of truth, reason, whatever you want to call it. If you deny that, which is given from God, the true God, not the God of perishability, this mirage of perishability and impermanence, the true God, if we deny that, then for sure, we will continue to be find ourselves confronted with perishability, and therefore try to desperately protect ourselves from it, which is pretty much all this world ever does. I mean, this is what we're engaged in. Oh, you know, I don't feel safe. I don't do more. I don't feel safe. Do more. I don't feel safe. You know, eventually you build a castle. With all soul. I don't feel safe. And then you get soldiers. And then I don't feel safe. I'll get more soldiers. And it's never ending, you know, it's never ending. I don't feel safe, you know. Why? Because within us, we don't like this. We don't like this dream of perishability. We don't like this mirage. We don't like it. We want to get rid of it. And we find that extremely dangerous. Continuity fear says that danger, 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 danger. Danger, danger, danger. Super dangerous. And so we just keep thinking that we can somehow make this mirage of perishability permanent. So we will suffer. We think, oh my gosh, I, there's something in me that doesn't want to continue with the, you know, perishability. This is very frightening to me. It's so terrible. So we're tormented. We're tormented. But again, as long as we mock and deny, we're Holy Spirit deniers, grace of God deniers, we will cling to this dream of perishability, this belief system of perishability, and believe it to be real, and then try to adjust to it. But with faith in the Holy Spirit, it's a whole different story. We can turn towards the imperishable and recognize that there's only the imperishable. All is, you know, already home. Everything just a play of appearances. Our dislike of impermanence, we feel it threatens us. It's terribly threatening. Terribly, terribly threatening. So we try to get rid of that. Somehow through projection and displacement and all sorts of egoic tricks, try to lower our fear levels. Getting dark quick now, that is for sure. Very quick, very fast. Sign of the times, isn't it? The way that hurricane developed. getting dangerous real fast. This is what I've been told, and more signs of this is accelerated. There's this extreme exponential acceleration taking place. And again, what might seem to be very, very preemptive may just be, you know, get out of Dodge as fast, you know, just in the nick of time. That's actually get out of Puerto Vallarta in time, or at least, you know, maybe that's what it really is. Now, it's a little difficult to wrap our minds around what we're talking about, imperishable, imperishable, but we're doing fine. We don't have to knock it out of the park instantly, you know. We can keep looking at this and get used to it, familiar with it, so we're in familiar territory. I can experience the imperishable. I will experience the imperishable. I am experiencing the imperishable right now. Another funny thing I recognize today is that people would rather be ignorant of an option they have, opportunity, and miss out on it. They'd rather miss out on an opportunity, not even know about it, than know about it and they'd rather not know about an option than know about it but feel they're missing out on it. This is the way that the mind works, that projects itself as a world. It's just a mind projecting itself as world, really, is all this is. All this is, that's it. So the mind says, hey, I'd rather not even know a way out of this nightmare, rather than no way out and feel like I'm not sure how to do it, you know. Well, this is pure cowardice. I would say the world is in this extreme mode of cowardice right now. They really would rather just not know. They say, no, I'd rather not know there's a way out than know there's a way out and feel like I can't make it. This is absolute cowardice. And this is how the world really is. This is why they're very different used to be. They think they're playing it safe, say, no, I don't know any way out. This is a permanent mirage of impermanence. There's no way out. And so they just feel, well, I just have to make the best of it then. Whereas if they saw a way out, and they said, oh my gosh, what happens if I don't make it? You know, this is terrible. It seems so difficult. I don't know if I can do this. Oh, it seems more stressful, right? But, you know, there's a saying, no guts, no glory. Well, this can certainly be applied here, no guts, no glory. You cannot just be gutless and coward, craven coward, and say, no, don't even tell me about some way. I don't want to hear about it. Because what if I don't feel I can do it? That's horrible. This is the attitude of the world. They don't even want to hear. They do not want to hear about it. So the mind is heavily defended against all this stuff. I'm experiencing it, heavily defended. But it was all loosening up today, all loosening up. Heavy, strong defenses all are being unraveled. And so you just have to say, okay. It's like, don't pull too tightly. Like when you're unraveling a knots, don't, you know, yank on this, yank on that. Just say, oh, it looks like it's coming undone, but I'm not going to try and, you know, struggle with it. Let's just artfully loosen a little bit more up, keep loosening it up, and be patient. Now, we might say, well, I'm getting glimpses of how I used to feel. Well, that means how you used to feel would be more tinged towards perfect, feeling perfect, and only honoring time, not worshiping it. So the more we get pulled into worshiping time, the more our experience becomes very, very fearful. And so when we were young, there may have been times where we're not worshiping time so much, right? And so we, you know, have this really very, very feeling like everything's perfect. So it's not a matter of going back being childish at all. It's just a matter of how much time worshiping are we time worshiping? Are we time honoring? And how much time honoring are we doing? And the less we do, the more we get this feeling of perfection. It starts, you know, it's dawning on us. Hey, everything's perfect. It's all perfect. The mind wants just to drop, you know, drop out of this. We just have to recognize it and say, okay, mind, you know, well, we're just getting used to this. There's so much fear around this. But it's better than being in Jalisco tonight, that is for sure. I mean, can you imagine the nighttime they're having there? Good Lord. That's ridiculous. I think 157 flattens framed homes. If 157 roared through Silicon Valley, every home would be flattened. All the trees would be too. But unfortunately, they do reinforced concrete down in Mexico for the most part, but not all the concrete is equal either. I mean, the mixes, you know, I mean, it's not all concrete is equal, and roofs certainly, windows, you know, wow, better board up those windows. So when we're looking at in great depth like this, it's okay. You know, we get tired, we get a little drowsy, we just like, oh. Of course. We recognize insights at this point. You know, they're going to be gems. So we say, oh, there's another gem. Okay, I'm used to gems. There's another gem. Pulled out another big gem. Okay, place this over there on the table there. And let's go look for another one. And it's like that. You just keep pulling out these really big gems. Bigger and bigger and bigger gems. And I'm just like, ah, okay, that's great. Nice gem. Lovely gem. Put it on the table. And let's go look for the really big one. I know it's here somewhere. In fact, however, it cannot be found, can it? And this is what we're starting to realize. It's everywhere. The gem that we're looking for is pure spaciousness, and there's only pure spaciousness, actually. It's kind of like making our way through heavy snow or in high elevation. You know, it's like, ah, it's hard to breathe. We're not used to it. We're not quite acclimatized to it. So every time we go even deeper into our, you know, defensiveness and fears, we almost, you know, like almost be asphyxiated by the fear. And we need to get acclimatized to it. But then once we get acclimatized to it, we feel, ah, this is a piece of cake. How was that ever difficult? Very, very interesting. That bee, that drone that came by a couple days ago, maybe a week ago, and was in the light. I have a fixture around the light, and it's dusty. And the bee was doing all these on its back, kind of circles like now. And I'm looking at this now, all these circles that they're embedded in the dust, all these dust trails that cleared the dust out. It's going around in circles, really fast, going around in circles. Isn't this extraordinary? Because that's what the hurricane is doing. This is really quite extraordinary. I wonder, what is that crazy bee doing? Why is it doing this? Why is it going around in circles? Frantically going around in circles. Wow. Like I said, everything is just the mind, a projection of the mind. It's just one mind projecting all of this. So consciousness is aware of everything. If there's nothing separate from consciousness. Bees are not separate from consciousness, and there's nothing. Everything is just consciousness, is another way of putting it. Everything is actually pure consciousness. It's all. It's not things. It's just is pure consciousness. We've heard this before, and we say, "Ah, what are they talking about?" Well, we're inquiring into it. So this bee. Somehow, seemed to tip us off. Certainly looked, I've never seen anything like, I've never seen a bee act that way. It was different than a dance in the hive or anything. This was totally different. I said, this is completely bizarre. What is this, what this bee is doing? And yet, it could very well be a depiction of an extremely severe hurricane. And the day before the hurricane hit, this man's talking about extremely rapid intensification. He says, I believe that there's going to be this extremely rapid intensification coming. And it's exactly what happened with this hurricane. Maybe the most amazingly rapid intensification of any storm we've ever recorded. And the isobar, the barometric pressure, is the lowest in recorded history. That was at 7. Down to 778 or say somebody. I mean, it's never been this recorded this low above a cyclonic event ever. They're calling it the biggest storm in history, and it popped up in a day. So get this, hear this: the biggest storm in history popped up in a day. This is exactly what we're have been passing the warning out from the Holy Spirit, saying we're going to reach a time, a popcorn time. Now, popcorn's a good analogy to use. You sit in the microwave and we're looking at it, looking at it, looking at it, looking at it. Nothing much is happening. So, yeah, isn't this microwave working? It's supposed to be heating up. Yeah, but it's not working. And somebody comes and says, hey, folks, you better prepare because pretty soon this microwave is going to be full of popcorn. It's just, and we say, what? Doesn't look like it, Then nothing's popping. Maybe one will go, poop, little one, poop. Say, oh, another little poop. Say, ah, that's it. Ah, no big deal. And then suddenly it reaches the threshold, right? The threshold where the popcorn suddenly starts all stop starts popping very fast. Boom, 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 and we could be living in a popcorn world. Maybe this is planet popcorn. Because we just had a storm pop up. The biggest storm in history just popped up out of nowhere. 20 inches of rain. I mean, we're talking about, you know, torrential flooding too, and mudslide. I mean, we're talking about just extreme weather popping out of nowhere. Now, once the popcorn starts popping, who's to say that it won't, that it, you know, who's to say that it won't stop, won't continue popping? Who's to say it won't continue popping? That we reach some threshold, once we cross a threshold, which is what the scientists have been saying, that there's some threshold. If you, once you cross it, there's, you know, the popcorn starts popping. You can't stop the popcorn from popping. This is a possibility. It seems to be this what the Holy Spirit has been warning about, along with non-dual teaching. You see, we don't want to lose sight of non-dual truth just because the popcorn is popping, because really nothing is happening. There's only pure spaciousness happening. There's only invulnerability. There's only imperishability happening. There's only permanence happening. And at the same time, the situation may get so severe here that we might think otherwise, right? So it could, it's potentially threatening to the non-dual path, I would say, the pathless path. It's easy to fall into the spell of a path instead of the wow of the pathless path. Wow, there is no path. Wow, I see that there is no path. Wow, I see, you know, this is the real, the wow of the pathless path can be very threatened by a pop, by planet popcorn, because people will be thinking, well, this, you know, what is this? I mean, it's so startling, it's so, you know, shocking. And we keep thinking, oh, definitely, you know, there's perishability, there's impermanence, there's instability, there's all this stuff. So when you say, no, there's perfect stability, there's only a mirage of impermanence and perishability and instability, but it's just a mirage. Well, that becomes very difficult to assert when you've got 200 mile an hour winds around you, even though it's true. So the non-dual, the pathless path of non-duality, the non-path of wow, the pathless path of wow, can get maybe prohibitively, you know, forbidding, you know, difficult when the popcorn starts popping. So maybe this is why Jesus is promised to come back at the end of the age and take those who wanted to his dwelling place. Because he's saying, hey, look, you know, it could get prohibitively difficult here. And of course, we're looking at the popcorn and we're saying, well, a couple of things pop, it doesn't seem so bad. And yet the Holy Spirit says, no. Once a threshold is crossed, all hell is going to break loose. Well, all hell, at least in that area of Mexico, all hell is just broken loose. That is for sure. I mean, if you in this area here, all the trees would there'd be no trees left, really, I don't think. Because there's not many palm trees. I mean, there's certain trees, like palm trees, that are used to dealing with severe hurricanes. But even then, 165, that's going to snap them. Just like Tacloban in Luzon, Philippines. I believe it was Luzon, but maybe not. But anyway, yeah. They snapped the palm trees. Even then, were just shredded, snapped. Just couldn't take it. Couldn't take it, so... It's like atomic bombs hitting you without the radiation, but my gosh, everything's just flattened. So it's pretty difficult, and as that is being broadcast. You see, here's the problem with the world. Anything that happens anywhere in the world is being broadcast and amplified, you know, to an extreme extent, live on television, right? So this keeps pounding home the notion of perishability, vulnerability, instability, you know, hopelessness, you know, all this stuff. makes the non-dual, the pathless, non-dual pathless path of wow, it makes it very difficult for those who are, you know, struggling with it. Even for me, it's difficult after all these years, 40 years really, or more than that. I mean, I was struggling, I've been struggling with it my whole life. And so even for me, it's still extremely difficult, very dangerous. Because everybody wants to talk about it and emote, and convey attitudes, beliefs, which are completely opposite of the truth. You know, and they want help make, you know, impermanence, help make impermanence happy, you know, not so dangerous, not so bad, or let's make it permanent. If we can just make it permanent, maybe it'll calm down. And, you know, they clutch at straws, they're clutching at straws. So when the whole world's clutching at straws and believing in a falsity, clutching at straws, believing in falsity, is really difficult. So a preemptive, you know, Christians talk about the rapture a lot, okay? Yeah, well, they argue, well, when is it going to be? And they try to set dates, you know, even though he's not supposed to. So, but the idea is, you know, preemptive. It's not any good if it's after, because then we will have fallen back into delusion, fearing the true God and worshiping the false image, displaced image of God, believing, you know, impermanence, believing in perishability, believing in instability, believing in all this and this. So we will have lost momentum, lost our momentum. The whole point that I see is Jesus, if there should be a plan, then it's preemptive. It has to be preemptive. And the problem in selling this right now is that, like I said, the popcorn analogy. We say, well, wait a minute, only a couple of kernels of popcorn have popped. You know, we better wait until some more pop. But Jesus would say, wait a minute. Once it crosses a certain threshold, all of it's going to pop real fast, and it's going to be so shocking, you may not be able to, you know, think clearly. So he says, you know, preemptively, we need to do it now, because it's not a stretch to say that it's, you know, justified, because you have to recognize this threshold and the popcorn analogy. So it is possible here. This is an extraordinarily interesting tell we're having now. Hurricane Patricia. And, you know, hurricanes are just named alternate male and female names. They just alternate. So there's no bias or anything possible. You start with A, and then you just go through the alphabet. And it's a historic fact that hurricanes with female names have been much more severe than ones with male names. And this is something that just, like, you know, humanists, they just hate this. They say it. But again, whether you start with Allison with A or Andy, you just, you know, you see a tropical disturbance in your name, and then the next one is the opposite. So first one's Allison, you know, second one is Bob, you know, then Claire, and then David, and whatever. But counting them up historically, measuring them, the female hurricanes have been much more severe. And here we have the most powerful hurricane in history, you know, and it's Patricia. And when you look back, like Hurricane Camille, Hurricane Katrina, and, you know, various ones. There have been other male ones that are strong, for sure. Andrew and Hugo, and, you know, but just historically, they're more severe. Go figure, huh? Go figure. Interesting. And this one is got real severe real fast, which is very interesting, because I've been talking about how social engineering has targeted women. Now, it's a very interesting dynamic that we need to talk about here. And if you'd see it in this way, is social engineering always targets women? Because that's the whole key to it. It's the family, it's the children. And the world is not controlled by decisions made in the boardroom. The world is controlled by decisions made in the bedroom. Plain and simple. This is a fact. And so women control that situation. And so social engineering has always targeted women. Always. And there's been so much of that historically. you know, historically, if we say, well, who has, you know, let's see how to put this, that because so much effort has gone into social engineering women, they seem to be more resistant to the pathless path of non-dual wellness. They seem to be more invested in the ego this way. But that is because if they're not if they're not heavily invested in it, the whole thing could fall apart. You see, they stop having children. Right? You see a lot of women who start wising up and they just say, I don't want to have any more children. I don't have children. Forget it. This place is hell. You know, this is delusion. I don't want to pass my delusion on to my to children. You know, it's not right. It's not fair. It's not good. So if women start waking up, then it, you know, it's the end of this. You know, the dream of bodies is quickly going to, you know, dwindle away. And so the fundamental social engineering that this dream is involved in is to convince women that this is all real. This is all there is. This is the only option there is. There isn't anything else. And so they have to be constantly propagandized and by the mind, by the ego. So you might say women are more egotistical. Well, it's true, but why? Because they're targeted way more than men, actually. And when you say, well, men have escaped. Well, that's true, very true, because they're not targeted as much. And the ego say, well, that's okay, you know, let some men escape, that's all right. But we got to keep the core nucleus of women believing in this dream, of keep buying into this notion of producing bodies, at the body, you know, the whole thing. Otherwise, it's curtains for this. So, you know, our continuity fear says we've got to make sure the women are on board first. And the men, you know, will, you know, once the women are on board, most of the men will be on board too. And if some of them escape, well, what the heck, doesn't really affect our core. So this is a fact. So if you look at it that way, you say, huh, that's interesting. And you know, the historical record of the reason why more men have escaped is not because there's some bias or some male conspiracy or anything like that at all. It's just the opposite. It's the ego conspiracy to make sure the women stay true to this dream of impermanence and imperishability, so that we don't drop it. You know, so they say they're gung-ho. They want women to be gung-ho about it, so they will have children, tell the children, hey, this is great, you know, welcome to the world, so happy you're here. And they want to teach them, you know, the big lie here that the mirage is true. And this is what spirit wants also. You see, spirit wants to come into a world where the mothers are gung-ho about self-delusion, of course. They want to be taught perishability here because they're, you know, they're afraid of the continuity fear doesn't want to drop that. So we reincarnate. We want mothers who are gung-ho on self-delusion. So there's all this pressure on mothers, on women, to be really gung-ho and cheerleaders for the ego. Now, it's also a fact that they are. But now we see why they are. So it's a little, you know, it's a little different than what we thought. And by no means is this intrinsically means that someone happens to identify the, you know, woman, female body. They don't intrinsically have to be gung-ho at all. Not really. But it's very difficult to, you know, they tend to go into compromise. Their efforts toward salvation leans heavily toward compromise because the ego is telling them, begging them, please, please, I'll give you anything. You know, I'll make you all princesses. I'll make the men your slaves. Just don't, you know, inquire too deeply here. Let's just come up with a compromise. So they tend to adopt compromises. Very adept at that, actually. Because I say, well, I just can't, you know, leave the ego entirely. It just seems like that would be too devastating. Because in a way, you know, what they're saying is the, you know, seems quite too devastating, because then, you know, it would, the dream might seem to be evaporating so quickly. People say, oh my gosh, you know. So, you know, it's plausibly logical to make that connection. So I said, no, I need to compromise. I can't really do it like that, you know, it's too fast. I can't, you know. So I tend to go slower, tend to be adept at adopting compromises, which, of course, for the men who really want to escape, this is, you know, a nightmare for them. It's just, you know, it's so there tends to be, you know, this dichotomy there. Because Because for a man, it doesn't really matter. Well, escape, it doesn't matter. Well, women, you know, they're the only ones going to have children. The man says, well, who cares if I'm, you know, if I escape this delusion or not? The women will just keep having children, and they'll just indoctrinate them, and you know, it doesn't destabilize the the dream of instability. It doesn't really destabilize it that much, you see. But if women were really to start waking up, it would be severely destabilizing. It really would, which is great. It would shake everything up, but it doesn't seem to happen. They seem to adopt compromises, the very clever ones. But they say, I can't go further than this, you know. And Jesus' whole thing is you can't compromise, can't make any exception. You can't say, well, yeah, okay, all this is true, but then this one, no, this is perishable, but everything isn't, else isn't, but this definitely is perishable. You can't do that. It's impossible to look at it that way. So it's easy to get the illusion of spiritual progress when women are put in charge of spirituality, which they are right now on the planet. You get this illusion of progress. But what it really is, they're just bringing up clever compromises, just compromises, which Jesus says is the worst thing to do possible. This is the biggest illusion, is to adopt clever compromises. So he says over and over, you must not make any exception. Otherwise, you have no chance. You will be severely deluded. So there's this illusion of progress on this planet. Illusion of progress. Because women say, don't worry, we're in charge. And we'll come up with a really good solution. It's not quite as severe as you guys were trying to, because that's too severe, you know. But we have something that's amenable to all parties. You know, the egos say, oh, you know. Okay. We'll keep that. You know, and then, you know, freedom will say, oh, okay, I'll keep, you know, a little bit of freedom and a little bit of not freedom. The problem is, this is still completely delusional, trying to deceive God. It's the same thing. God is entirely God. You know, truth is entirely true. This is what truth is. So, we get led down the primrose path, which we most certainly are right now. The realm of spirituality, by and large, has just been absolutely taken over and completely dominated by females right now. They use male figureheads is all they do at this point, just to say, well, look, we have a nice compromise, we're fair. And yet the male has to say, yeah, you know, this will work, you know, this will work, even though it's a compromise. And so this is another super dangerous situation for the non-dual path, this path of wow. The whole point of the path is to accept no compromise. It's impossible. It's like saying part of the mirage is true and part of it isn't. This will only cause deep, worse conflict within the mind, because the part of it that recognizes it's none of it's true and wants to drop it will seem to be, you know, severely conflicted with, you know, another, you know, belief system of the mind saying, no, you have to drop your desire for you know, no compromise. You must drop it. And of course we can't, because what we really want is truth. And in truth, there is no such thing as untrue truth. There is no untrue truth, none. There is no true perishability whatsoever. There is no true instability whatsoever, none. Zero. So that's what we really want. This is how God created us. So we will create a tremendous conflict, an inner split, dissociation split, as we go forward with a planet, a consciousness based on clever compromises, you know, which women are very good at, because they're put under such pressure from the ego belief system. It's saying, if you drop out, the whole thing will just go to pieces too fast. And they say, oh gosh, I don't want that. And, you know, nobody really wants that to go to pieces too fast. So it's a tricky thing. It's a tricky thing. And certainly the men have to make the most of their opportunity, where they're not under the same sort of extreme social engineering pressure that women are under. So there's always a group of men in the world who are really going for it, for true liberation. And, you know, they're seen as having a higher, you know, escapability quotient, so to speak, than usually the women who are working at it, who are usually willing to settle for some clever compromise. Usually, not always. And so this is the way you look at it. This is just a fact. This is just how it is. It's just how it is. You can't change it. You cannot change it. The belief in changing it is just, you end up in another clever compromise. It just happens to be the way that it is. As long as, you know, this is the dream. I mean, this is bodies. Identifying with believing in bodies is the dream, right? Really? Time, space, process, and form. And how that plays out. And we all feel like, wow, I think we want another body here. Please, 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 don't stop having bodies. Now, if we, you know, you do it in test tubes or something, it might be a different story. But even then, you know, there's a feeling of responsibility to the dream that women seem to, you know, that are told that you're responsible for this. It's all a psych job by the ego, by our continuity fear, really. That's all it is. And but yet there it is. You know, it's just because we see it doesn't mean it's going to disappear. However, seeing it opens up more clarity, and we, it loosens up the knots. I say, why have things been the way they are? Some hideous male conspiracy? No, it's not. And then you start dropping that, you see, and then you start saying, hey, okay, I'm a lot, you know, wiser than I was before. And then you could start, you know, the inquiry becomes more fruitful, much more fruitful for everyone. Certainly, the more that are liberated, the better it is for everybody. Men and women, absolutely it is. I think women are being putting themselves into a hideous position here in this world by demanding that all spirituality be a form of compromise. This is an extraordinarily bad situation for them. They won't have anyone to turn to at some point, except the ego. And the ego's not, you know, won't let them off the hook. No way. So the more that are, you know, truly liberated in spiritual in the world, the more true sages there are in the world, whether they be male or female, the better it is for everybody. And if it happens to be, you know, usually it's more men, for sure. Well, if we take a radical feminist viewpoint, they say we want quotas, you know, and this is not fair. We want, you know, we want women to take over because men have had their time. So if you make it very difficult for men to reach liberation, to be a true sage, and there aren't any anymore, where do you turn to? You see, this is the big problem. But this is what is coming to now. This is becoming prohibitively difficult for men to be realized, you know? Really is. Because it's this old, this quota thing, like, hey, wait a minute, you know. It's our turn. You know, it's like, you know, childish game of we're taking turns here. Okay, it's our turn. You know, wow. The truth is, whoever can do it should do it. It's not a matter of taking turns. It's whoever's willing to do it, do it. We're desperate for it. And yet this idiocy of thinking that there's some, you know, male conspiracy against women, that kind of thing, that has prevented them historically from having high positions of spiritual authority. They only look at it from that angle of spiritual authority. We want to have the spiritual authority. Of course the ego wants them to have spiritual authority, because then we'll be dealing in compromises, which is the heaviest delusion of all. So that is a bad, bad path we're going down to, actually. Very, very bad path. Men should be encouraged to seek enlightenment, realization. Everybody should be. But we shouldn't place, you know, all these, you know, radical feminist ideologies in the way of men. This is, you know, self-destructive, incredibly ruinous, actually. Because men are basically now just saying, well, you take the lead, you know. They're trying to be gentlemen and say, okay, it's your turn. This is a radical misunderstanding of the situation. It's not about turns. The ego is the ego taking turns, saying, okay, you get to be enlightened, now you don't. No, the ego being expression of our continuity fear is saying nobody gets to be enlightened. That's the ego's position forever. It's trying to make this mirage of impermanence and perishability permanent, which means we can never escape it. That's its goal. It's not taking turns. This is a complete lie on the part of the ego. It's just using that as a marketing device because it's very, very effective. The men are just saying, oh, I feel guilty. It's woman's turn. No, it's nobody's turn. We don't take turns. It's whoever can do it, do it. And the fact that it's more difficult for women just means that men have to work extra hard to make sure they do it to help them out, you know? That's the real fact of the matter. And women used to be way wiser than they are now. They realized that. And they benefited greatly from it. And we're going into a dark, dark, dark age right now. Where you might have a whole big world full of spiritual yoginis, you know, but no enlightened sages whatsoever. And this is a disaster. Because then the great faith that is required to shift from worshiping time to honoring time isn't present. And so you end up worshiping time and trying to put a ribbon on it. Trying to put lipstick on that pig. Really. And you spend a lot of time, a lot of delay trying to dress that pig up, you know, in some way so it's no longer a pig. Worshiping of time. And spirituality is the worshiping of time, plain and simple. And there's not been, you know, that many who have broken through this and seen the non-dual truth, that all is just, you know, pure spaciousness. Always has been, always will be. There's no instability, there's no impermanence, there's no perishability, there's none of that. It doesn't even exist. It's all a perceptual mirage, a belief-based mirage. There's not been that many do that. And those who do that are extremely precious. And to devalue them merely because of the gender their body appear to be, that happen to be men, is crazy. You know, it's egoically insane. But this is what's happening. I mean, this world would rather have a time-worshipping spirituality female as authority and follow that than a liberated sage who happens to be a male. They say, oh, no, you know, it's not your turn. We're going to listen to her. You know, this is, again, is you know, get out the cuckoo clock. It's cutting off your nose to spite your face is what we're dealing with in this world. Now, with the habit, the ego said, we've got to have women in positions of authority because the men are starting to get tired of this thing and they're looking for liberation here. And we might have too many of them get enlightened and this might cause a snowball avalanche effect. So we really got to get women in more involved in spirituality so they can, you know, weave these clever compromises that men will say, okay, that sounds pretty good. We're good enough. Again, decisions in this world are not real. The crucial decisions are not made in the boardroom. They're made in the bedroom. This is something the ego understands very well. And we need to understand very well, too. There's another thing. It's the whole thing of dumping all the problems on the world upon corporations. This is really not true. That the crucial key spiritual decisions are made in the bedroom, not in the boardroom. Plain and simple. So I see, you know, women are just digging themselves a terrible, terrible hole. And I've been saying this my whole life, trying to sound the alarm, tell them, hey, you know, they don't listen. They say, well, you know, you've had your time, you know, being listened to. Now it's our turn to be listened to. And which is, again, incredibly stupid. If something really bad is happening, something sounds alarmed, just say, well, oh, well, that's a male fire alarm. We're not going to listen to that. We're listening to this female fire alarm, and it's not ringing. So, you know, there's no fire. You know, this is very stupid. Critically stupid. But this is what we're getting now. And again, this way Jesus may be saying, hey, you know, this is a disaster here. And you don't want to get caught up in this because you're going to get caught up in some compromise for sure. The whole prevailing belief system of this planet may get caught up drastically in the idea of worshiping time in a, you know, clever manner. Right? And but how clever is that? You know, how clever is it to not repent? It's really bonehead stupid is what it is. You know, it's like insanity is doing the same thing over and over, expecting a different result. You know, it doesn't work. It does not work. But no one will be allowed to say that. You know, they'll say, no, I've got to say I'm happy. If I'm not happy, I need to take a drug. So how fast can this coalesce? Well, this can coalesce extremely rapidly. And it may, you know, may happen, who knows? Just boom, overnight, suddenly, there's coalescence. Now, for example, don't want to pick on this person because this person is just in perfect standing with the one spiritual family. It's not really a person. It's a spirit who's absolutely in perfect standing with, and will always be so, okay? Just like everyone else. But the personality, you know, the fake self-personality is a different story. So we can talk about that, but I want to make it clear that there is no judgment on this person's spirit, this spirit at all. But I would say that Hillary Clinton is the last person in the world that any one of us would want to have to be president of the United States. You could pick anybody else in the world and that would be a better choice. And yet this is the person that is seemingly headed toward being the president of the United States. This is insane. This personality has got all the wrong stuff. I mean, it's an absolute disaster. This personality will push the planet in the wrong direction as fast as possible. It is a disaster. All the wrong egoic compromise, lying, deceiving, you know, putting a bow on it and saying it's not a pigism. It's all wrapped into one bundle. Here's the ultimate, let's put lipstick on the pig and call it good. So this just shows you how crazy the world is right now. Literally, you just go in a crowd and pick out this person, go to the local supermarket and the cashier and say, hey, you know what? Let's have you be president. And they would make a vastly better president than Hillary Clinton would. Just because they wouldn't mess it up so bad. You know, they wouldn't push in the wrong direction so bad. They say, yes, let's just keep watching football on Sunday and call it good. Or whatever, I mean. But they wouldn't push it in the wrong direction so badly. Same thing with the current president. Is an expert at pushing it in the wrong direction as fast as possible. But Hillary Clinton's even worse. This again is said from a standpoint, spiritual standpoint. You know, again, I my attitude towards everybody is I love everyone, is because I know we're all one spiritual family in absolute perfect standing with reality, perfectly, you know, eternal life and all. So, you know, God bless everyone. God blesses every one of us perfectly, and the Holy Spirit has freed us all from continuity fear already. So she's already free. We're already free. But some are worshiping, so caught in worshiping time that the continuity fear is so severe, they feel they need to perfect the worshiping of time. And this is one of those personalities that is wants to perfect the worshiping of time. Couldn't pick a worse, you know. So madness in the world to even consider such a thing. But I'll guarantee you, though, many, many people feel this way. I mean, most people I talk with, and I don't really bring it up much because everyone says, well, I don't want to be critical of a woman. You know, well, we're talking about, not talking about a woman, we're talking about a personality, actually. It's a personality, really, right? That's using the facade of, a woman to say, don't criticize his personality. But it's a personality. It's a personality. And same thing with the president right now. Personality, you know, it doesn't have anything to do with his skin color, race, or anything. It's a personality. Very, very personality driving us in the wrong direction as fast as possible. It's like an engineer racing a train so fast, you know, the train's gonna go around that turn and flip and train crash. You know, it's an engineer's out of control. You don't want that engineer driving the train. You absolutely do not want it. And yet, you know, maybe the majority of the people are saying, yeah, we'll go for that. Huh. Yeah, wow. I wonder why Jesus is back and saying, this is the time now. I mean, these are the days. This is the epic. This is when, you know, it's go time now. It's go time. And that may reach a point very quickly where people, the majority of people decide, okay, let's go this way. If she managed to lie her way out of every possible, you know, nasty situation that she's gotten herself in already, you know, just, she's a train wreck. This has been going on a long, long time. Since the, you know, since when her husband was governor and then, president and secretary of state. And it's been a train wreck going on and on. She's just lying and lying and lying her way out of everything. Deceiving, pushing blame here and then, just it's unbelievable. But this is what, and people are just willing to say, oh, well, no big deal, no big deal. It's a big deal. It's a very big deal. I mean, just the idea of that personality in charge of the presidency, it's like, hey, time to jump ship, really. Get out of Dodge now type of situation. And so this is from a spiritual standpoint, what I've said, looking at it, realizing you don't want this attitude. This is the wrong attitude to have in charge. And it's sickening. It is really revolting and worrisome. It's like a severe hurricane suddenly coming in, But if it coalesces and this is how it's going to go, I'd say, hey, Jesus, hey, time to go. It's go time here. Let's, we need to be insulated from this world. The non-dual path is very difficult. The pathless path of wow is quite difficult to stay, get motivated, to get started and to stay motivated. It's quite difficult. And the situation can become so inimical to it that it becomes prohibitively difficult, really. And backsliding can happen. This is what Jesus warns about. He said it'll become so bad that even the saints are in danger of backsliding. Well, that is hideously bad. Kind of like that Hurricane Patricia right now. So what I'm saying is it may be a subtle little reminder that this female name of this hurricane that popped up so quickly is relating to the world events, that the females are going to take control very quickly, and it's going to be extremely nasty situation for the non-dual path, because the way of the egoic way of compromises will be dominating, severely dominating. And anyone who doesn't go for that will be labeled as, counter-revolutionary, really. And this could happen very fast, very, very fast. I mean, it I don't know what. I'm not following the politics right now, other than just the faintest, the faintest, the faintest of peripheral vision stuff. I have no idea how the Republicans are doing at all. I have no clue. I saw the first Trump bumper sticker in the Silicon Valley today. No, first time that there's one in the Silicon Valley. So I don't know what's going on. I did hear there's something, a little blurb, that's only six left, whatever that means. I don't know who they are. And I did know that Joe Biden dropped out, which means Hillary Clinton's a virtual assured the nomination, unless she's in jail. But even then, they'll probably nominate her. Of the Democrats. So, who can possibly beat Hillary Clinton in the general election? Probably, I doubt any of the Republicans really could. So, we're headed straight towards Hurricane Hillary, actually. Be the worst hurricane in history. And I've known about this for a long time. Long time. I said, if that lady ever gets to be president, we're all in big trouble. I didn't think it was really possible. I said, just people are not that stupid. And yet it seems now they may be ready to be that stupid. Because I don't think, Trump is going to fly, because, he's just, pretty much a climate change denier and a build, build, build. Let's be, build, 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 but be more industrious. I don't think that's going to fly, after this United Nations in Paris and then accountability meeting in July and stuff. I think that the conscience of the planet is going to veer severely in environmental direction, and his record just, it doesn't fly. It won't fly. He's obviously, he's a builder, Let's build more buildings, this and better buildings and bigger buildings and more luxury and all this stuff. I mean, build more golf courses, whatever. People are just not, going to, accept that, because they want an a different attitude. So we could be heading straight for Hurricane Hillary, and that is one hurricane that makes Jalisco, look like a nice soft tropical breeze. The Jalisco hurricane, Patricia. 200 miles an hour. Ah, it's nothing. Just a nice, soft little tropical breeze here, No. You know, we're looking at like, you know, 400 mile an hour winds, so to speak. Ideological winds will be 400, you know, 450 miles an hour or something. try to protect your mind when, you know, your thought, your spiritual path, when there's these headwinds of 450 miles an hour. Ideological headwinds. Again, the Bible says it will get so bad that even the saints will be in danger of backsliding. What are they talking about? Natural disasters? No, that's not going to cause it. Well, that's part of it. But ideologically, that's what will cause a saint to backslide if it's too severe ideologically. Too much guilt, too much pressure, too much all this. So, hey, I don't care, you know, who goes. I mean, if there's a way to take shelter, I don't care what the demographics are. I'm not going to be sitting there with some quota system. Well, you can't go get him. We got this amount of races, this people from this race and this gender and that gender and quote. There's no quota system. Jesus doesn't run a quota system. It's whoever is willing to go. That's it. So I don't really care, you know, who is and who isn't willing. It doesn't make any difference. You got the right stuff. You got the right stuff. Plain and simple. Willing to practice, you're willing to practice. You're willing to say no compromise, you're willing to say no compromise. That's good. That's it. Yeah, you repented, you repented. You say, then there's no compromise. That's repentance. There's no compromise. There's no time. There's no space. There's no process. There's no form. There's no lack of freedom. There's no concretization. There's no trace of it. There's none of that. Zero. It's zero. This is the repentant path of repentance. This is what it's all about. And then accepting that there isn't any path back home because you can't leave home. We never left home. So how can there be a path back to it? How can you approach it? You know, it's a pathless path, an approachless approach. This is why the wow has to be there. This is the reaction to the realization, wow, there is no approach. See, as long as we're stuck in an approach, we'll be judging and good and bad. And this is the false path of worshiping time, actually. But when we realize there is no approach, it's the approachless approach, then the reaction is wow. This is why we have to constantly focus on the wow and bring it to mind. And when we bring this wow to mind, automatically the insights start to flow. We're in the right perception of it all. That there is no coming home. Wow. Because we never left home. You know, ultimately, there's no prodigal son. We never left. There's a prodigal dreamer. But, you know, the dreamer, the realization is that I never left. I never went anywhere. It's not that I arrived back home, no. I never went anywhere. There's nowhere to go. You can't leave home. It's truthful to say we cannot leave home. It's impossible. And that's what frightens us. Because we're trying to find a way back home. And so in the worshiping time, we get all freaked out and say, wait a minute. There's no path back home. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. I need a compromise here. Let's work a compromise. Let me turn to a displaced idol God and work out a compromise and believe that this idol God is true God and build up a religion around that, spirituality around that, and let's call it good. This is the attitude of time worshippers, okay? Obviously, though, if there's no path back home because we never left home, what is there to panic about if we really repent and say, hey, wait a minute. Wow. This is a mind blower. Wow. It's neither reaction. I don't need to find a path back home, right? I don't need to find it. Wow. So I'm already here. Yeah, wow. So automatically it brings up this wow reaction when you look at it in a non-dual way. Automatically, you can't escape it. You cannot escape it. Because it's immediate. You realize the solution, I already have it. I mean, I don't even need a solution. I mean, I never left, you know. I just have to accept it. Wow, 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 wow. So it's a different reaction. It's a non-dual. The wow is very much a non-dual reaction, as it were. It's the one reaction that's non-dual. And it doesn't go any further than the wow either. It just does. It just full stops in the wow. So you have to accept that it full stops in the wow. It doesn't go any further than that. And speaking of a full stop, I may have to do a full stop here. I have to help out. But I'm in the big wow right now. This is really intense, isn't it? It's fantastic. Wow. So whoever, whoever wants to repent, repent. And whoever wants to help, be helped, absolutely. But there are no deals to be made. There are no compromises to be made. Don't ask someone to compromise. Say, well, it's not fair, and this. No, just keep repenting and stay in the wow. Stay in the wow. That's the deal. That's the deal to be made. That's the one deal to be made. It's just the wow of it. Wow, I'm already free. Wow, there is no homecoming. I never left. And there's a shift that's made, ultimately, I believe, from believing that you're the one who's arriving back home to realizing that that's the fake self that's making a journey back home. That's the dream, a dream stick figure, actually. And that the real one is still in the home, just having this dream, projecting this dream out, and they never left. This is the shift that ultimately was what people call, sages call enlightenment. Ultimate enlightenment is this shift. Shift in perspective, and I'm working on that. This is what we're working on, making this shift in perspective here, and not freaking out about it. Not saying, oh, wait, I have to have the one who arrives have this euphoric realization that they have arrived, otherwise how can I be happy? This is not true. No, nothing has to happen to that dream figure that seems to be arriving. Nothing at all. They should just have them sit down quietly. I had a dream last night where I was looking at this shelving and all these shapes that seem to be cut out of the shelving, and they said all this depth and all this stuff was happening. I was just like entranced by this, but I said, wait a minute, and I went around behind the back of the shelving, and then I saw it was completely flat. It was all an illusion, all hallucination. It was absolutely flat cutouts, and then immediately I said, hey, wait a minute, okay, let's just sit down here quietly in the wow. I'm not going to do anything about it. I just let me get used to it peripherally. I'll just sit here quietly because this is all I need to see. I don't need to do or see anything else other than this. So have the stick figure, your dream figure, projected self, the self projecting itself, just sit down quietly. Just have it sit down quietly. That's all that's needed. And just get used to the truth. That's all we have to do, is get used to the truth. The truth is already true. We don't need to make it true. We don't need to arrive at truth in order to make it true. It's already true. We just need to see that. And so in the dream, I saw it. I saw it, and then I just said, okay, let's not make a big, let's not have the dream figure you run around telling everybody, oh my gosh, No, just sit down quietly. Just sit quietly. Just sit in silence. Sit quietly in silence. This is what may be the best way to look at it. So, we will see, right? I know some have intuitively said they'd like to see me, sit in silence. I take it as their spiritual intuition saying this, that this is what they're seeing. So it may very well happen that way. Absolutely, I would be up for that. This seems to be the appropriate way for the stick figure to. For us to put the stick figure, just sit there. It doesn't have to be, hey, I arrived home, everybody. I finally arrived home. This is great. No, that just perpetuates dualistic delusion, actually. It really does. Ramana Maharshi was right. Just sitting quietly. This is the best communication of the non-dual state, actually. There's no arriver. There's no attainer. There's no realizer. There's nobody coming from outside home and realizing I returned home. It doesn't exist. So he just has the body sit there quietly. And then the gaze is not the body, it's spirit. The presence is spirit. He says you have to feel the presence of peace from the sage, otherwise it's not a real sage. Again, he's right again. So, it's not surprising that we're getting Ramana Maharshi right now, 65 years after he passed away. Because it takes a while to look at it and inquire. Is it, wow, what is this? I've been working on that my whole life, really. I was aware of Ramana Maharshi fairly early on in life. He was very well known. I mean, he was kind of a cause celeb at that time, right? Spirit from the spiritual circles. Absolutely he was. I mean, Razor's Edge, Somerset Maugham is about Ramana Maharshi, I believe. And there was a lot of buzz in the high spiritual intellectual circles about Ram Maharshi. So I couldn't understand him. You know, I didn't get it. I said, I know it's there, but I don't get it. Why do I not? Why? How come I don't get it? It's very frustrating. But now we're really starting to see it. You know, we're really starting to mature. And Ramana is aware of it too. He absolutely is aware of it. He's come to me in dreams and says, I'm aware of it. You're doing great. This is very auspicious, you know. He's loving it. He's absolutely loving it. Well, you know, the great teachers come in, they take the long view. They understand that not many will come to them in their lifetime necessarily and be enlightened. But it's later down the road that, you know, we give ourselves time to mature into it, you know, and recognize the non-dual path. Wow. You know, it's a lot of wow involved, a lot of continuity fear involved. So he said, hey, I'm still with you 100%. Believe me. In fact, even more than ever, he says, I'm going to be, with dropping the body, I'm going to be even more engaged with you, even more potent with you. He said, I'm not going anywhere. I'm fully, you know, here and back in your efforts. Believe me. He says, this is truth. So I believe him. I believe him. I believe all these teachers are absolutely intensely with us, backing all our efforts here. And it's we need to mature is the issue. It's not that they're not backing us. It's just we need to enter into greater non-dual maturity and get this. I'll just sit quietly instead of, hey, I'll go running around, you know, telling everybody that, you know, I'm so elated that I'm enlightened, that I made it, and I finally arrived, and I finally achieved, and I finally attained, and I finally got it, and I finally, like this, da-da-da-da, you know. Shifting to, and I just sit quietly, This is a huge shift, especially for the Western mind, you know. And I think some are saying, that's what we need. And I appreciate that, you know, viewpoint, absolutely. You know, I'm coming around to that concurrence, we'll see. But it's I can see the potential, you know, potentially, the validity of that. I mean, it's in the air, you know. Well, we'll see how it goes. Because spirit needs to say, yeah, I know, I never left, okay. But I have this stick figure that's in the habit of, you know, I'm in the habit of projecting this, you know, attainer, you know. So I need to just, I don't want to keep projecting the image of attainment, but how do I have this with a stick body? Everyone feels that it's the purpose of attainment. How do I convey there is no attainment, you know, involved? Maybe just by sitting quietly. Not saying anything, like Ramana. And people say, what do you do? You know, but we'll see. Whatever's right will be what's right. And this is how I took it in the dream. This is what I did. I know it was the right thing. I know it was the right thing to do. I said, just sit quietly. Yeah, I said, yeah, I know. Just sit quietly. So when the shift of perspective happens, then you could say that there's someone is now enlightened, actually. You could say that. I think that would be fair to say. So there's a lot going on right now, to say the least, and it's late October, which is the best time, most auspicious time for me in the yearly calendar, by far. It's an extraordinarily auspicious time. So here we are, you know, pursuing a very auspicious line of inquiry here. So that's absolutely great. Doing my best here. It's not easy. It's Friday. I'm very tired. I worked very hard this week. Very stressful. So I have combat fatigue from driving constantly through the Silicon Valley. It's battle fatigue. There's no question about it. It's just brutal. I think I said the guy I know quit his commute, his job, because it was 5 hours, two and a half. Some people said it took him 3 hours to get to work. If there's an accident, it'll take you 3 hours to get to work. And a lot of these, I mean, this is crazy what's going on here. And Google says, let them ride bicycles. You know, we're building more campuses. We're going to employ tens and tens and tens more thousands of people. And we'll let them ride bicycles. You know, let them eat cake. Yeah, right. I mean, we have to find a job that's, you know, 100 miles away. Let's ride a bicycle to work. We've got to carry heavy loads. Let them ride a bicycle. We need to hire more people. Spread our gospel. Empower, spirit time worshiping. Spirituality. Make time worshiping more spiritual. This is what the world's engaged in. Make time worshiping more spiritual. Big mistake. And mistakes, again, when you go down that road, you will always be confronted with perishability, You'll always feel that you're in this scenario of perishability. This is what happens. There's no way around it. And that is not fun for anybody. I don't care how spiritual you try to make time worshiping, you still feel the feeling of perishability. And that's what bugs us. That's what we hate. Okay, we'll never be able to change that. We'll always hate the notion of perishability. We'll always want to spit that out. And so they'll always be conflicted. So it's hell. It's hell. Hell will always be hell. Got to tell you the truth. The hell of believing in perishability, this mirage of perishability, will always be hell. Doesn't matter how much lipstick you put on that pig. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter at all. Will always be hell. We will just try to displace, 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 displace. It'll be constant efforts of displacement and keep calling it good, and then find out it's not good. That's all we can do. Displace and call it good. And then hope, 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 hope. We get lucky. Believe in luck. End up believing in luck. Whole planet's turning towards gamblers now, believing in luck. They say, maybe we'll get lucky with Hillary. Yeah, good luck with that. Luck's got nothing to do with it. It's a certain thing. We hate this mirage of perishability. We hate it. Always will. It's not true. But we don't want to live believing in this mirage. Absolutely not. So you've got to take the pathless path if you want to evaporate your continuity fear. Otherwise, you will continue, everyone will continue to keep worshiping time. There's no way around it. The continuity fear locks us into it. Unless we work on diminishing its intensity, we'll remain stuck. This is what all the great spiritual teachers say. Unless you really work at it with a lot of faith, you'll remain stuck. There's no way around it. I've never heard a great teacher say otherwise, actually. And clarity supports, what they see. It absolutely supports it. Got to diminish the continuity fear. Repent, 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 and then work, 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 work. Wow, so strong. I get a little distracted. Get a little distracted. Come back to the wow. Have to watch your mind. It'll run off into scenarios. Just stop it. Just honoring time here, not worshiping it. Now, if you come into this world, everybody here thinks that you're here to help them worship time. Put a bow on it. Put lipstick on the pig. You say, I'm here to help you. They say, great. Good, so we know exactly what you're here for. And then they immediately pigeonhole you into this someone who's going to help them put lipstick on the pig. And also try to make it, the mirage permanent. Permanent mirage. Which is impossible because it's just a projection, our own projection, and we don't want it. So we'll never really want it to be permanent. It's impossible. We can never truly desire that this mirage be permanent. So it won't be permanent. Can't. Impossible. Never will happen. So they think automatically this is what you're here for. So everyone pigeonholes you and they say, they're wonderful, great, a savior is here, but now we know, and we're willing to worship you and all this. And you say, no, 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 no. And they just say, what are you talking about? I mean, what are you, hypocrite? Are you a liar? I mean, we know what saviors are here for, what you're here for, so you got to do what we know you're here for. And this is a great battle here. It's a great trouble. It's a great trouble. And none of my mom would get around this by just saying, well, I'm just a stupid, illiterate little girl who's kind of retarded. Something happened to me, I guess. Maybe something happened to me. I'm not able to understand what you want me to do. I'm sorry. That's how she got around it. She was able to, I just fib a little bit. She got away with it, you know, because she just was adamant about it. This is why she's able to function so well. Otherwise, you know, they try to pigeonhole you, put you, and you just sit there, you know, silently, perfectly silent. People say, oh gosh, I guess she's got brain damage or something. Yeah, some severe brain damage. Isn't that awful? Maybe during birth it happened. She said, yeah, maybe something like that happened. Yeah, I don't know, but so it's really that severe. She had to do that, you know, it's so severe, pigeonholing, that they said, no, we know what you're here for. This is what you're going to say. This is how you're going to act. This is what you're going to tell us. And she said, oh, you know, I'd love to, but, you know, I guess I don't know. I got some mental defect. I'm not able to. And then she'd tell them the truth, and they go, oh, wow, really? Oh, that's pretty severe. I don't know about that, you know. She goes, wow, sorry, you know, maybe I'm a little crazy. What can I say? So they had a hard time getting mad at her, you know. Just, how do you get mad at, you know, just a little retarded child, you know, brain damage. Oh God, isn't that a shame? It's awful. She's such a nice, wonderful, loving person. I feel so much of peace there, but somehow her mind's not functioning properly. It's awful. Wow. And they feel compassion for you, and you say, oh, yeah. Unfortunately, you know, this is the dynamic of the world. This is why it's so difficult for, you know, you say, where are all these great teachers? Well, it's the world insists they know better. Oh yeah, great teacher, great, we know what you're here for, so we'll just support you in that and let's get going. And you say, no, that's not it. What are you talking about? We got to get back home. What are you talking about? No, we never left home. There's no journey back home actually at all. You just have to bite in the wow of this and evaporate your continuity fear. Huh? What? What are you talking about? You must be crazy. Well, yeah, I don't know what I can say. I can say, well, yeah, maybe, I have to come up with an excuse. What can I say? I'm just a stupid man, you know. I'm suffering from, you know, from being a stupid male. I don't know what I can say. We'll see. I just don't get it. You know, I just don't get it. You know, oh yeah, I know it. Superiority of worshiping time, but I'm just, you know, I guess I'm just a born male chauvinist who just can't get it. You know, meanwhile, you know, let's abide in the wow here and evaporate our continuity fear and recognize that there's only home. You know, there's only home, and therefore, you know, abidance is the only condition there is. Actually, it's the only condition there really is. So, wow. Yeah, this terrible male chauvinist. He can't help himself. What can you say? He's just old school, you know, old school there. They don't know better, you know. It's a pity, isn't it, really? It's a shame, you know. I don't know. At the cover of something, I don't really know what. Maybe it will emerge, you know. Anyway, yeah. Now, I'm not watching the hurricane. I'm not watching the game, etc. But, you know, I might check in, you know, just by the internet or something, say, you know, how's it going? You know, I know people from there, Kalima, you know, I know good people. You know, it's a shame what's going on. And, you know, Mexicans are very good people in general. You know, it's a shame what's going on. You know, it's affecting a small part of the country. Now, of course, might come over to Texas, and severe flooding there in Texas. You know, that's another shame. I mean, they got too much water there. Why don't we bring some to California? My gosh, you know, what is this? come on. Everyone's saying, hey, come here, hurricane. Come on, you know. 20 inches, we'll take it right now. They'll fill our lakes up right now. They'll fill our lakes up in one day. Let's get it. 20 inches, come on. Might float the whole countryside out into the ocean. 20 inches of rain. In a day's time or something. A couple days. I don't know. The rivers, I mean, this is not good. I mean, Mexico is just getting so much rain, that coast. I've seen video of the farms, ranches, the creeks turning into 100, you know, foot raging torrents. Yeah, they get more. This is going to be very intense there. The reservoirs are already completely full, okay? So there's no way you can trap any of that water. It's all going to be runoff. And the rivers are already choked full. So this has a potential just to spill into the countryside. I mean, it's just inundate the air. Inundation. Wow. It's really intense. And this is the way the world is going. Inundation. We have the danger is we're going to be just completely inundated with a certain ideology, and we just feel like we're just worshiping time. Let's make the worship of time seem very spiritual. And that's it. I mean, I've been talking about this over and over and over and over and over, maybe in different words, but I've been, you know, really pointing out, hey, you know, this is extreme danger we're in. I call it like a wildfire, you might say, but inundation. It's trying to make the worship of time seem very spiritual, more spiritual. You know, which is focusing on form, dressing it up. Then we could be absolutely inundated by this, just sudden inundation like this hurricane. I expect it, actually. I really expect this to happen. I think Jesus knows very well it's going to happen. So does the Holy Spirit. So do spiritually minded beings on this planet, right? They expect it. So the real inundation, in my opinion, is a time worshiping inundation of, hey, we can all make it more spiritual, and that's going to be good. That compromise will finally work. We'll say we don't need to honor time. We'll just worship time in such a profound way that we'll call it good. That's all we need. This is the wrong path. This is the wrong direction. This is a train wreck, and we could be inundated by this ideology overnight, almost overnight. And Jesus is not going to just sit back and let us all slip back and lose our momentum. I just don't see that happening. Why else would he come back like this? Give us a course in miracles. He must have known that, you know, massacre is coming. Because he challenged us. This is not just your normal non-duality. This is intense non-duality. Super intense non-duality. So much so that a lot of non-dualists just write it off and say, well, I don't get it, you know. Well, it's because it's so intense. It's so challenging. So he challenged us very severely, and he always told me, go faster, faster, faster. This is a challenge. This is urgency. This is not the slow way anymore. This is fast. You got to go fast. This is in dreams. I'd have him appear to me in dreams and challenging me, go faster. So he knows an inundation is coming, a massacre is coming. Of course, we got to be ready for it. And again, like this storm popped up overnight. Who knows what's going to pop up overnight next here? Could be every single night something pops up. Every day something pops up. Popcorn popping up all over the place, which is why I've stopped watching the news. Now, I noticed this, and I wanted to check on my friends down in Mexico, make sure, you know, see that they're okay. And fortunately, it's missing them. But still, I mean, it's going to hit and do this devastation anyway, right? And shock the consciousness of the world, right? Absolutely. But I don't want to watch the news, because something every day is popping up every day. It's crazy. I'm sure. I get it, just the vaguest, most distant, faint traces of it, just enough to know that someone says, well, there's some, shooting, that's about it. I just say, okay, I don't need anything more. Yeah, whatever. Right, another shooting, okay. Where is it? What happened? I don't need to know anything about it, you know. This is already known that the intensity, this popcorn is going to be popping, and it's not going to stop. Once the threshold is passed, the popcorn starts popping. Hell's a popping, as they say, as the saying goes, hell's a popping. And then time to take refuge. So, hey, hello, Jesus, come on down. Tell us what we've won, Jesus. Tell us what we've won. Come on. Yeah, absolutely. You have won an all expense paid vacation to a beautiful refuge where you'll be able to pursue your non-dual focus and walking together in the wow in the most beautiful, effective way. Oh, thank you very much, Jesus. Can I pack my golf clubs? Yeah. I gotta work on my putter. I haven't made any putts in a long time. I gotta get the rust off there, you know. And I haven't. I can't make those. Just keep, because the holes seem to have a dome. They're domed in some way. Just really hit it right in the middle. Hit it slightly right. It rolls off to the right. Hit it a little left. Rolls off to the left. And I say, what's going on here? It's crazy. Can't either. You got to hit it like absolutely perfect. I won't go in. I say, wow, that's tough. It's like I got a little more serious about it. I kept thinking, I can get it to go in here. Just get it, you know, make it hit a good one. But it doesn't seem to be working. Got to hit it just right, perfect, dead center, dead right, just right. But my lag putting is great. It's great. So that's good. Maybe that's all we need to do really great lag putting. You know, maybe we don't have to, you know, get it perfect right now. We just need to make sure we continue in the wow, walking together in the wow, in the realization that, you know, there isn't any arrival back home. The one that is arriving back home is just a dream, projected dream figure, which is the root of duality. And so we just say, just have it just sit down quietly, all right? Okay, so, great. We've reached the big mark, 2-hour mark. Means we've done a really big push here. We need to do a really big push here. Some people say, they talk to the hurricane, say, well, it's not happening to me here. It's not bothering me, so I don't need to pay any attention. It doesn't matter. Well, it's a sign, a heads up, and it's reflective of our thinking. Our beliefs, our projection, our mental projection. This world's just our mental projection, actually. There's nothing outside of the mind. So if we think there's something is not being caused by mind, we're deluded. This is all mental projection, and it's heating up. Hell's a poppin'. Hell is a poppin'. So very auspicious time now in October, late October. Keep walking together in the wow. This is what works. Walking together in the wow really works. All right, very great.